السلام عليكم جميعا ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته، وأهلا بكم في هذه الندوة من ندوات مركز دراسات التشريع الإسلامي والأخلاق. سنبدأ وستدار الندوة كالتالي. سنبدأ بكلمة ترحيبية لأخونا الأخ شوقي الأزهر نائب مدير المركز، ثم يبدأ بعد كلمتي الدكتور حاتم شنطي، ثم الدكتور طارق رمضان، ثم يكون الدكتور محمد نعيم ياسين، ثم يلي ذلك حلقة أسئلة وأجوبة وتواصل مع الجمهور.
We're going to give the floor to Dr. Shoqi Al-Azhar, who is the Deputy Director of the Center for Islamic Legislation and Ethics. In the name of God, the most compassionate, the most merciful, may the peace of God be upon his Prophet and all his followers and companions. Distinguished scholars, ladies and gentlemen, may the peace of God be upon you. I welcome you all on behalf of Center for Islamic Legislation and Ethics. We welcome you in this event. This is the first event that we have this during this academic year, and this expresses the identity of the center and the ambitions of the center. The center was established in order to deal with the latest issues through a methodology that would enable us to place the different issues within an ethical framework and to deal with these issues with all its dimensions, and to enable us also to overcome any attempt to be defensive and look at issues without trying to give alternatives or to change the situation in an effective manner. And the, amongst the main traits of this issue is to have scholars of the text and the context, scholars that would meet together in order to describe and try to come up with a solution. So the aim is not to achieve ijtihad through the different scholars to try to study an issue and try to come up with a number of criteria. The aim is to try to reach a kind of an ethical and comprehensive view in keeping with Islamic Sharia that would enable us to deal with the different issues and to find a constructive solution to the different issues that we face. And in that context, we would like to talk about the genome. It was very clear. All of them contribute to the building of the world of the future. We apologize, we're facing difficulties with the sound, so we're going to try our best. So they're going to look at the different issues from an ethical perspective. And within this framework, we do exert all our efforts, and we hope that God would help us. And may the peace of God be upon you all. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Mr. Shoqi. والآن سأتحدث باللغة الإنجليزية. كما قلت لكم كان من المفترض أن يكون معنا الدكتور خالد العلي وهو مساعد نائب رئيس الجامعة لشؤون أعضاء هيئة التدريس وهو أحد ممثلي اللجنة لجنة البايو أثيكس في اليونسكو. لسوء الحظ ليس بإمكانه أن يكون معنا بسبب زيارة طارئة إلى كندا, وبالتالي هو يعتذر لعدم تمكنه من الحضور اليوم, وبالتالي سنحاول أن نقسم الوقت. كنت أفكر أن أقسم الوقت المخول له, لكن أنا لأنني ديمقراطي سأخذ هذه الفسحة التي كانت للدكتور خالد وسأقدم مداخلتي. إذن معنا الدكتور محمد حاتم الشنطي المدير العلمي لمركز علم الجينات الطبي, والتقيت بالدكتور حاتم مرة واحدة فقط في اجتماع مع في المجلس الأعلى للصحة, وطبعا هذا اللقاء الوحيد مكنني من أفهم الجوانب العلمية والأخلاقية المعقدة المتعلقة بموضوع الجينوم, وأنا متأكد أنه سيكون مصدر لمساعدتنا بشكل كبير جدا هنا في المركز في المواضيع المتعلقة بالجينوم. طبعا دائما نواجه صعوبة في تقديم الشخصيات الإسلامية المرموقة المهمة. إذن معنا الأستاذ الدراسات الإسلامية المعاصرة, سأقدمه باللغة العربية, أور شيخ دكتور محمد نعيم ياسي. He is one of the Sharia scholars who haven't met before, but I have come close to his knowledge through his books, through his ideas in legislations, Islamic legislation and Islamic thought. He has got a number of research papers and books in medical issues, and he has got a number of ideas, especially the issues to do with the beginning of life and end of life. So we would like to welcome him in his first participation with us in the center, and this is hopefully not going to be his last participation. So I'm going to start. الآن سأبدأ بمداخلتي الآن أو المحاضرة التي سأقدمها.
When we speak about topic or field like genomics, genomics could make a very difficult equation, if we may say, in the modern time, by being a highly specialized topic and at the same time quite popular among public people. It is very highly sophisticated technologies related to genomics, extremely expensive most of the time. The Human Genome Project in the U.S. costs $3.8 billion. But at the same time, it is everybody's topic. Everyone speaks about it, journalists, politicians, theologians, as we see today from the speakers on our table. It is like this because it's not only technology, it's not only science, but it is something that closely intersects with core life issues in our daily life. People have very high expectations, common people and as well as specialists of genomics and genetics in improving health, quality, longevity of life, etc. As Francis Collins has said, the director of the U.S. National Human Genome Research Institute, that the Human Genome Project is just the start of a revolution in genomics and genetics that will change the face of medicine in the 21st century. And he says that for about 100 years now, we know that there is a power, heredity's powerful role in health and disease. We know this. But there was always a gap, there has always been a gap between this understanding and to translate this into goals of alleviating human suffering. This gap is shrinking almost on a daily basis because of the research done by specialists in the field. And as I say, very high expectations are increasing day in, day out. Specialists tell us about great benefits from research on genomics. One of the most important of which are financial in nature. The Human Genome Project, which is the archetype model of work on genomics in the modern time, cost the US government $3.8 billion. Huge amount of money. Batella, world's lead, largest independent research and development organization, in 2010 published a study in which they revealed the financial benefits of this high budget and expensive budget project. The US government spent $3.8 billion, but they got back $796 billion. So every one single dollar spent on the project returned $141. I would say maybe heroin and cocaine can bring more money than this. So it's hugely also beneficial, financially speaking. Plus this, the also $244 billion in total personal income, 3.8 million job years of employment. Every job year is equivalent to one person working full-time for 1 year. They said that only in 2010, the return of the project was $5.6 billion. So in 1 year, they got more than what they spent in 13 years of the project, between 1998 and 2003. So it can be hugely beneficial. You spent an enormous amount of money, but you get it back. But this we will need later when I speak about the debates within the Islamic tradition. They spend the money for 13 years, and after more than 10 years or 20 years, they started to get the results. So in balancing benefit cost-benefit assessment, making this cost-benefit assessment, we need to take into consideration the long and short-term dimensions. And we'll come back to this later. Also, one of the benefits is disease etiology, that we understand the nature of diseases now much better. Especially very difficult diseases like cancer, diabetes, heart disease, and schizophrenia. We now know more about, we can identify the genes that play a significant role in these diseases. Also, the new emerging field of pharmacogenomics, through which we can develop more effective drugs. Statistics say that more than 100,000 people die each year from side effects to medications that are beneficial to others. Everybody uses the medication, it works well, but there are 100,000 people who die from this medicine, which is quite good approved on scientific basis. 2.2 million experience serious reactions, while others fail to respond at all. So there are problems which are related to genes responsible for drug responsiveness. So work on genomics and on genetics can help to see whether a person is likely to have a good or bad reaction to a specific drugs before giving the drugs to him. This can also help. Expectations speak about the introduction of new gene-based designer drugs for diabetes, high blood pressure, mental illness by 2020. These are all great benefits. Also gene therapy, that genomics and genetics can be used as a therapy by itself. That in certain diseases, we can replace the defective genes responsible for the disease and replace them with the good ones, or just plaster a normal function such as immunity, in case of AIDS, for instance. With these great benefits, there is a need also to bear in mind that there are serious risks, and sometimes the expectations are not realistic. To start with the last one, gene therapy, scientific research speaks about series of disappointments in the research, that it didn't work, and sometimes it had even very devastating results, like the death of a man in the US medical trial in 1999, development of vector-induced cancer in a child in French trial in 2002. But still, experts say that this will not put an end to trials on gene therapy because it still has great potential in future. And I will come to this point also back. There are also possibly very serious psychological consequences and psychological risks, because sometimes genomics can help us with the prognosis, but it has nothing to do with treatment. So we know about the disease, we can prognose the disease, but people will just know about it and nothing more. So one can wonder, what's the point that I know within a decade or two I will get cancer, for instance, or my children or grandchildren will get cancer? What is the point of this? It's nothing more than psychological burden. Others will say, no, this can help people take preventive steps to reduce, at least sometimes, to reduce the risk of developing condition. Changing lifestyle, changing diets, avoiding environmental triggers, etc. There are also serious social risks, especially when confidentiality of the patients are breached and information are revealed to other people. Someone with sufficient knowledge can take someone's genome, which is a trigger of information, to decipher what we were once, before living in the era of genomic revolution, that we were once an individual's most personal and intimate individual and family secrets. They will not be secrets anymore. For instance, we can infer paternity or other features of the participant's genealogy, something which can be very destructive for certain families. Claim statistical evidence that could affect employment or insurance or the ability to obtain financial services for the participant. Many insurance companies wouldn't be willing to give a health insurance coverage for people who have high risks that we can read from their genome. For instance, what will we do if such type of information has been revealed? Also, it can be used for mean purposes, making synthetic DNA responding to the participant and plant it at a crime scene. It will be an evidence against you, etc. Revealing propensity for a disease currently lacking effective treatment options. It becomes known that this person, or maybe the family, or maybe the whole tribe, they have genetic diseases, which can dramatically affect their marriage opportunities in the future, for instance. So this is what we usually, as common people, hear from the scientific and medical community about this new technology, this breathtaking technology. When it comes to the Islamic tradition, we face serious religious ethical challenges for key concepts that remained more or less unstable, or we took them more or less by default for a long time. We have in the Islamic tradition now its own genre of fiqh al-muwazanat, especially for the new issues, in which religious scholars always try to make balance between the benefits masalih and the harms al-mafasid. And when the harms outweigh al-mafasid, then it's something good from an Islamic ethical perspective, otherwise it is bad and it should be avoided. In the field of mainstream bioethics, they develop more or less, have more or less the same tool which they call risk-benefit assessment. And risk-benefit assessment in modern bioethics is highly systematized and highly sophisticated. In a visit a short time ago to Imperial College of London, I heard from the specialists there that there are specialists only in counting the risk-benefit assessment. They have mathematical equations, they have theories by which they can calculate at the end is it plus or minus. They have formulas, very highly sophisticated formulas. In the Islamic tradition, I think the case of genomics can be a very good case which will help our religious scholars to develop such systematized thing. In our rich tradition, Islamic tradition, we had focus about individual harm and public harm, individual benefit and public benefit, and prioritizing the benefits and the harm, so that the benefits should be averted first, and then we talk about harms should be averted first, and then we can speak about benefits, etc. But for instance, the little information that I spoke about raises more questions about this fiqh al-muwazanat or sharia-based risk-benefit assessment. For instance, the economic aspects that we get for every $1, we will get $147 back. Is this a big benefit that should be taken in fiqh al-muwazanat or not? This expenditure, we got the benefits back after 20 years. This 20-year span, how should it be calculated in the risk-benefit assessment? Is it okay to spend $3 billion on a project in a country where people die because of starvation, for instance? For instance, in the US, they spent $3.8 billion and Americans didn't have national health insurance. Is this okay in Sharia-based risk-benefit assessment? When we spend all this amount of money and we get the results, how to distribute these results among the public? Equal access to healthcare. Are we going to give the benefits, the medical benefits of this type of research to everybody? Or only to the nationals who are living in the country? Or also to expats? Migrants, to whom should this be given? The short-term versus long-term dimensions, as I said, we spend for 20 years and then we expect the results. Genomics is investment in the future. We do research that its benefits may appear after we die. So how this time dimension should be kept in view? The example of gene therapy I mentioned. We invest money, we invest effort, and then maybe many people would die in the way before finding the right treatment. And then the results can be amazing, but on the way we have some losses. How to calculate also all this? The psychological dimension, how much weight should be given to this? We need prognosis to come to the treatment, but when we come to the prognosis, there would maybe psychological side effects to this. Shall we deal with this? Shall we refuse this, reject this, etc.? These are all questions. Also other concepts like the unseen and the seen, al-ghayb wa shahada. Al-ghayb wa shahada, they are key concepts in the Islamic tradition. And our understanding is that al-ghayb, alam al-ghayb is exclusive to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Its knowledge is only to God. And alam shahada is open for humans to explore, and they are required to explore this world. And infringing upon the unseen world is usually frowned upon in different journals of Islamic literature. It's not good to infringe on the unseen. And genomics is almost nothing but predictability, foreseeability, and exploring the future. By how this will be in contradiction with our normally speaking traditional understanding of the dichotomy between the seen and unseen. Are we crossing the frontiers of the seen and unseen? Do we go too far? And how far do we need to refine, maybe, to our understanding of the seen and unseen concepts? Maybe the unseen world is not always immutable and absolute. Maybe it's changeable and time-bound. What is now unseen may be tomorrow seen. And maybe our religion asks us to minimize the scope of the unseen and maximize the scope of the seen. So we always need to find distinguishing border lines for how far we can go or how far we can redefine these concepts in our tradition. And if we have this predictive information from genomics, which was usually unseen for us and now became seen, to what extent can the juristic rulings, the ahkam al-fiqhiyya, can be based on this predictive information? If a geneticist has told me that you will, your children will develop cancer if you get married with X or Z, this was unseen for me, and I could marry with this lady, no problem. But now I have this information, which is predictive in nature. Now, is it ethically problematic from an Islamic perspective to get married to her now, or to get children later on who may develop such type of diseases? Can we base juristic rulings on basis of this predictive information? These are all serious questions. Health and sickness also. These are key concepts that need to be revised now and maybe redefined. Many juristic rulings are based on health-sickness dichotomy. There are rulings for those who are healthy and other rulings for those who are sick. Almost in every chapter in a fiqh manual, you find this distinction. For instance, in marriage, we have a chapter about the defects, the diseases, on the basis of which the healthy partner can ask terminating the marriage because the other is sick, especially when this sickness can affect the offspring, can affect the forthcoming children, when they say, يَتَعَدَّى ضَرَرُهُ إِلَى النَّسْلِ. The harm can go further to the offspring. Okay, now we know through the genomics that diseases can affect the offspring. Shall we now enlarge this list of the diseases to include also genetic diseases? And this means that the future partners should reveal this information to each other? Or it's only a matter of predictive information and it's not necessary? If a geneticist or doctor is asking from a future partner to tell him about the genetic information of his future partner or his future partner's family, to know if it's okay to get married to this person or not, what should this geneticist or doctor say? By saying yes, he has problems, would he be revealing confidentiality of the patient? If he doesn't know, does it mean he's deceiving the future partner? What should we do about these issues? So to come to the point, we have extremely complicated and multi-dimensional questions in the field. This is general, almost for every tradition, for every philosophy of life. And Islam is no exception in this regard. And the panel today is explorative in nature. So the questions that I mentioned today, please don't expect that they will all be answered, or the questions in your mind. We're just trying to explore in which direction we can go, and what kind of questions should be raised, and how should we tackle them. We plan to make follow-up meetings in which we take such questions seriously, and to take both Sharia and science seriously. In our terminology, in the center, we use usually text and context. And questions should be raised in both directions. So it's not only that the information that we have, we give them to the religious scholars to tell us what Islam says about this, but there are also questions that should be raised to science itself. For instance, how should we define the human being now in the light of the ongoing genomic revolution? Does this genomic revolution usher a new epoch or a new age in which the identity of humans will be redefined in terms of DNA codes? Human being will be just a couple of DNA codes and genes, etc. Where should the concept of soul be positioned in the whole debate? We hope some of these issues will be discussed today, but many of these issues will be handled in follow-up meetings, we promise you, inshallah, in the future. Thank you very much. And now I give the floor to Dr. Hatim Chan.
$141 for every dollar that's spent on me, probably I just break even, but I'm glad we heard these numbers. So you heard a little bit in the introduction about how much was the cost of the doing the human genome. It has been a dream of mankind, actually, and towards the end of the 20th century to recognize the importance of knowing the human genome. The idea was to sequence or identify all the building blocks of the human genome in one person only, and then see how this can be propagated further. So at the beginning, there was the 3.8 billion that you heard were spent to sequence or to identify the building blocks of one person only. During that period of time, there was a lot of discovery that humans are vary from, or the genetics or the genomes of humans vary from one person to the other. So all, over the years, and by the end of the 20th century, before Francis Collins said his famous quote about changing the face of medicine in the 21st century, the idea became very well known that there will come the time where everyone will have or know what their genomic composition is, exactly as they know how they look like. So towards the beginning of the 21st century, people have gathered and tried to find out common grounds of what genomic information means to populations and means to individuals. So they came up with these recommendations that every adult has the right to know their genetic makeup. They have the right to know that. And they have to know the implications of this genetic makeup on the health of their offspring. So and you heard a little bit of that from Dr. Ali's presentation. And they need to be educated about their own genetic makeup. So if you give them that information, that and they know their genetic makeup, maybe it does not mean much. but they need to be educated about it. And we'll talk about this for a second, in a second. And they need to have services available for this knowledge that they acquire. So if they acquire the knowledge that I have a genetic makeup that puts me at risk of developing cancer or dying from cancer, then I need to have the services available for taking action regarding what comes out of this. Maybe diagnostic service, maybe treatment services, maybe preventive services, whatever the services are. If I have knowledge that I will die by being hit by a car in the next 10 years or so, then I won't leave home and I won't cross any street because I might be hit by a car. But if I know this information, what should I do? So the genomics studies right now, when the price of sequencing one genome went down from $3.8 billion to $1,000, a lot of studies are coming up. And these are based on two types, actually. The most common is the first one, which is population-based. And that's where you look at a certain population, like the Arabic population, for example. Although this is not done, but you get a population, you get a representative sample, you choose people at random and make sure that they are not related, and then sequence those people and calculate how variable they are from each other. What are the common variations that are present? So 60% of them are, have long noses, for example. So that's a quality that you need to look at by doing this population-based genome studies. You identify also the rare variants that, very long nose, let's say, and from that, from rare variants and common variants, you can calculate disease risk in a population. We're not talking about individuals, we're talking about the population. Now, the other type is where you do clinical genome and exome sequencing. You don't bother with the terms, but where you do genomic studies for individuals for clinical purposes. And that's important to understand, because this is this will be done for an individual with the possibility of identifying why this person has a birth defect, or why has a genetic disease, or why has a common disease, whatever it is, but also with the purpose of individualizing the treatment, so giving that person a treatment that you know will work for his or her disease. The other thing is the pharmacogenomics or predictive genomics as well, where you can predict certain things, predict the response to a drug, predict side effects to a drug, predict that this person will be obese or fat, or predict that this person might develop heart failure, or might develop cardiac disease, heart disease, whatever. But also it can be used for preconception, or what people usually mention as premarital screening, where people who are going to get married get genomic studies done at any scale. And to predict whether they can have children with genetic disorders. Some people where marriage is not that respected, some communities will do it preconceptionally before they have children, but also it can be used for prenatal screening while the baby is in the womb of the mother, or it can be used as for neonatal screening when the baby is born. You can identify what genetic disorders this baby has. Now, it sounds very nice. These two types of genomic studies sound extremely nice, and probably once you look at that structure, you will be fascinated by the wealth of information and the wealth of knowledge that this can produce. But at the same time, it raises certain problems. One of the problems is the equitable access to genomic services. So people with who have who actually think or have the right to know their genomic structure might end up not being able to access that facility because of insurance, because of money, because of whatever it is, but also they might be prevented from having access to services that they might need after knowing their genomes. There is an issue of privacy and confidentiality. This is a wealth of information about one individual. So it's as if you're putting all the information that you know about yourself in a book or in a notebook or whatever, where someone can peek into it and know certain stuff about you that you don't want people to know about. So confidentiality, maintaining confidentiality, is an issue that comes up all the time. Disclosure of genetic information. So that genetic information, if it was going to be done and just handed off to you and say, here you have it, you're not going to make a lot of use of it unless it is disclosed to someone. To your physician, to your healthcare provider, whatever, but it can also be disclosed to insurance companies, to people who like to peek into things. So the disclosure is important, who gets that information. And then the freedom of reproductive choices. So if you give people some information that from your genomic structure, we think that you might have children with a birth defect, then you need to tell them what to do in order to avoid having that child with birth defect. And then the incidental findings, which we will talk about a little bit at length, which are findings. So you, when you do a test for, I mean, for physicians, they know this quite well. If you go to a doctor and you tell him, I want to measure X in my blood, I want to measure my blood sugar, he will measure your blood sugar and tell you you have diabetes or you don't have diabetes. I'm simplifying things, but this is practically what it is. But if you go to a physician and you tell him, can you do me a panel of tests? One of them is blood sugar, but there are another 15 or 20 different things that can be measured. You might know that you have kidney failure when you do these tests, which intentionally you didn't want to know. But because of the price of these 20 tests was exactly like the price of one test, so you did them. It will not harm, but actually it might harm. So when we do population-based studies, there are certain issues that come up with that, and it depends on the design of the study. Most of the studies that have been done at the genomic level have been population-based. So non-paternity can come up. If you are sequencing a child and parents, then there is a possibility that you can identify that the father is not the father, and that brings up an issue. Most of these studies are done, you know, anonymized somehow, but relationships and gender are maintained. And, you know, when you anonymize and then you find out that there's no paternity, how you are going to deal with this in a sample. Confidentiality and privacy, which we talked about a little bit earlier, is the same thing. What are you going to do if you find things that you want to disclose to these people, but you know these are a random sample? And not, you know, and not a specific thing. Then the consent. How are you going to consent these people? These are the ones who are going to participate in a population-based study. How are you going to consent them? What are you going to tell them? In my feeling is that you should actually look at them and tell them. That, you know, we're going to take your blood, we're going to do sequencing, and you're not going to hear from us anymore. And actually, we won't know who you are once we start the study. If you do that and you, you know, try to consent people, they will not agree. They want to know some information, but at the same time, they don't want to know a lot of information. And they have a different view of what this information means than what you, as a researcher or as a even a healthcare provider, want to do. Then there is what is called the loss of function variance. So the human genome, I said, is very variable. And a long time ago, whenever before the human genome, whenever we found a change in the genetic material that might explain disease, we say, yes, this is the one that explains the disease because it is a serious or loss of function variant or loss of function mutation, TOFRA, whatever we call it. Now we found out that people actually have this loss of function variants or TOFRA, and they are living with it and have no problems at all. So in a study that followed the first genome and a little bit afterwards, they took some samples from individuals and they calculated what, these are all loss of function variants. So they found that on at minimum, every person of the ones who are tested, and probably this reflects on us as well, will have 100 of these that might be discovered. And he didn't know about them, he or she didn't know about them, has been living without any problems, and maybe it doesn't mean much. Actually, there are two people, important people, who are the extension of this study. Greg Venter is one of the people who were competing to complete the human genome before the NIH, and then he joined hands with Francis Collins and did the work. When he did his own genome, he found that he has more than 200 of those. The other one is Jim Lupsky, who's a famous geneticist from Baylor, who actually has a genetic disease, and he's been searching for the reason for his own genetic disease that he has. He has weakness of his lower limbs. And in the pursuit of this, which he found, but he identified that he has more than 200 variants that if anyone tested for those, he would have told them, oh, you have this serious variation. Now for the genomic, clinical genomic approaches and so on, there are other ethical issues that might be raised. Now we heard about the population, but for if you do it on individuals, then you run into problems that are within the same broad lines, but are specific for the clinical genomic sequencing. Access to genomic services again. So even if you for some odd reason you get your genome sequenced, you will run into problems of what is the post services that you need and whether you have access to that or not. Access to healthcare services as well, whether it is related to your genomic prediction or not. So for example, if a lady goes in, or if two ladies go in and ask for the genome to be done, maybe both of them will struggle to get to convince the physician that this is what they need. And but somehow they get it done. One of them, both of them are identified with a mutation in a gene called BRCA1, which we know predisposes to breast cancer, and they can be affected by breast cancer. Now, one of them might get access to good healthcare, where they tell her, "You need to do a mammogram every 6 months, and an ultrasound, and maybe a biopsy if we find something, and then we do a lumpectomy, and we do, I don't know, radiation or chemotherapy, and the outcome is wonderful." The other person will be told, this is very expensive, so the best thing is to have bilateral mastectomy and removal of both breasts, so you don't get breast cancer. And that was the option that was given because of the availability of healthcare services to number one and number two. consenting. So when you consent people, it is very serious when you tell them we're going to do the genome. You need to sit down and explain to them what will come out of this, what information, what added information or added knowledge you will get when you do this. And then they have the chance of agreeing or not. Now, if you want to do this for children, who's going to consent for it? Who's going to take that decision? I always tell my children that I'm taking good decisions on their behalf because I know more than they do. Now, once they grow up and become teenagers, they think that all of that I said was bogus and nothing is serious. So what if I take a decision of that sort for them? It is serious. It will stay on my conscience for long. What if I know that my 5-year-old or my 10-year-old will develop cancer when she's less than 40 years of age? Why would I want to know that information? And at the same time, why I don't want to know that information? It might be helpful for her. So it's an issue that comes up. And then counseling. You know, I went through an experience of this, and people are counseling me for who did my genome, but no information, only about 1,200 genes, which is 5% of the number of genes in my body. And they sat with me for about an hour and a half to explain to me the variations that they found in this 5%. If they are going to report on all the genes in my body, they probably will need 2 or 3 days. We cannot get manpower to do this for every individual. So the counseling is definitely going to be of lower quality. We need to we need to expand that capabilities, but then everybody will be working as a genetic counselor. The other thing is recognition and reporting of incidental or identifiable findings. So in this incident, they are not instance. They are not incidental findings. These are identifiable findings, because people ask for their genome to be done. They ask for that one test, which has, you know, millions of results. What are you going to do with those? Again, disclosure of genetic information. Who's going to tell, or who you are going to tell this genetic information? Are you going to put it on a chip and give it to the person and say, here's your genome? You know, what help would that be? Is that going to be part of the medical record? So you're going to disclose it to a bunch of people who can have a look at it. Some of them are, you know, healthcare providers who take care of things, but some of them are evil people. Privacy and confidentiality comes in. Risk to relatives. If you identify that one person has a risk of developing cancer, don't you need to tell the sister of that person that she also is at risk because they share a number of genes between them because they are sisters? Who's going to tell that sister? Are you going to tell the first person that you identified the mutation in that please go and tell your sister to come and have her genome done? These are all issues that come up. Who's going to do this? So this is an example that I always give about what people call incidental findings or identifiable findings. The one in A there is a very serious birth defect, where the brain is actually not formed well, and it affects the structure of the face. So you have the two eyes fused together. There is no nose. There is structure above the eyes that came up because there is no nose. The picture next to it is someone whose the eyes are still close together, but the nose formed, but with one opening only. The third one, the nose didn't form well, and there is a big clefting in the face. The third, the fourth one down there is the head size is small because the brain malformation is there, or the brain anomaly is there, but then the eyes are closer together. Now, these are all serious birth defects, but it is a birth defect that is related, that is passed from parent to child. And if you look carefully at this mother in the picture over there, she has her only manifestation of this serious birth defect that is caused by a mutation in one gene is that she has a single central incisor. So instead of having two teeth in the front and the top, she has only one in the middle. So she actually has the risk of having children with any of these configurations, or having a child with who looks exactly like her, has no problems except that tooth. This is Tom Cruise, who's a famous actor, who actually has a single central incisor, and he chose not to know whether he has this syndrome or not. So in the last couple of minutes, I'm just going to talk about what is really, from all what I said in the last 15 minutes or so, what are the key issues that we care about in our Arabic culture? I think the most important thing is the equitable access. This is, to me, is the most important thing, equitable access to that technology, to healthcare, to all the modifications of healthcare. الإسلام دين مساواة وعدل. This is an important thing. Why would one person have access to this and another person does not? And in the Arabic culture, again, this is extremely important. Now, the other thing is women and children. Women and children are children, I set the example of taking decisions on the behalf of your children when they are young. But also women tend to have people, or their husbands, or maybe parents, or fathers, or whatever, take decisions on their behalf as well in our culture. So who's going to protect these from any information that comes out of genomes? The third thing is stigmatization. We talked about, Dr. Ghali presented this wonderfully, we talked about premarital testing, people going to get married. Now, if you or anybody in our culture finds a bride, or a future bride, her brother is blind, for example, because he was born like this, he would be very careful before marrying that person. And some people do not stop at that, but go around and say, she comes from a family with genetic disease, she'd probably have children who are blind. That's very stigmatizing in our culture. And it carries around for a long time. And I've seen this happen over and over again. Then the last thing is the family and tribal issues. Again, if one person knows certain information, how is that person going to relay this to his or her family, or to even the more extended family, or what we call the tribe? Again, these, I think, are key issues in all what I presented. But again, consenting is important. Counseling is important. All of the other issues are important. But I think these are on the top of the list. And I'll stop right there. I think the questions will be at the end. The questions are answered. So thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank Dr. Ghali for being very much involved in organizing these meetings, and all the people who are coming the last day before Jumu'ah and then Eid, and kul am wa antum bi khair. May Allah bless all of you, inshallah. Because many things were said that are important and I will rely on them when it comes to this question, because I think that there is a danger in that field. And the danger in that field is that we are trying to be very specific and very specialized when it comes to answering the details, while genomics, by definition, is questioning the whole picture. Tell me how, as Fuqaha, you deal with genomics, I will see the way you look at the world. And in fact, very often, this is something where we have to be very, very cautious. It's very risky. Dr. Ghali just mentioned many things. Dr. Hesham to the same. And I think that I will try to rely on this. And before having our Sheikh Yassin responding to some of the questions or putting some questions, I just want to raise some critical questions when it comes to this. And especially because here we are dealing with practitioners, we are dealing with state decisions, because this is also something which is essential. And it has to do also with very specific fiqh answers when it comes to implementing some of the knowledge or even the technologies and findings that we have. First, let me say something from an Islamic viewpoint, which is once again something here, which is the title, is that we are coming back to a very clear relationship between science and ethics. And we have to make it as something which is essential. In the world today, it's as if, let the scientifics do the job, and yes, we'll talk about ethics. And everywhere in the world, ethics is on the margin. We consult, but there is no constraint. There is no power of ethics anywhere. The power is with money and the power is with knowledge. And from the Islamic perspective, the discourse on this should be a resisting discourse to the current discussion about technology and knowledge, which is ethics is essential in anything which has to do with the way we deal with sciences and especially on this. Because as you have seen, the consequences here are huge. And especially in Muslim majority countries or Arab countries that are just trying to catch up with what is done elsewhere. So at the end, we are catching up with technologies and we are putting as a secondary questions, the ethical questions. And this, by definition, the power struggle when it comes to science is pushing us in that direction. So the first is to question this, is to question our positioning when it comes to science and with things that are important here. And very often you can see that the scholars, and this is in our Torah, in our tradition, something which is so important is that when the scholars were talking about akhlaq al-mihna, which has to do with the profession, they were very comprehensive. You can see that the different dimensions were there. But here we're not talking about this. We're not talking about akhlaq al-tabi. We are talking about an akhlaq in a very specific field, which here needs to be comprehensive as it is. And it's much more complex. To be comprehensive with the field as we were comprehensive with the profession is completely different. It means that there is something which has to change completely in our understanding. No way to deal with genomics if we don't come back to a comprehensive understanding of sciences altogether, ulum. Which means here that we need to come to this understanding in this. And from us as Muslims, we need to be clear that we are re-questioning the role of religions and the role of philosophies in anything which has to do with science. This is the starting point of our discussion. The second thing, as I was saying, when it comes to genomes and all what was said about the DNA and the way we are dealing with this, is that once again, through the discussions that we just had now from two different angles, we had connections between different fields. So the first is we are talking about health. No way today to talk about health if you don't talk about technology. No way to talk about technologies today if you don't talk about knowledge. No way to talk about knowledge today if you don't talk about economy. No way to talk about economy if you don't talk about rights and society. No way to answer these questions if you don't start with a comprehensive approach. Meaning all these fields are connected. Because at the end, there are decisions that are going to be taken, even here in Qatar, saying national preference. Based on what? On what are we starting with the people who have the same nationality? And it's not the same status as human being. وَلَقَدْ كَرَّمْنَا بِنِي آدَمْ means that when it comes to health, your nationality is not coming first. That should be our understanding. And the money should become not come first. So if we enter into something which is not questioning the whole approach, we might end up responding accurately to details and completely wrong as to the big picture. So this is where fiqh and fuqaha should be also involved in a better and in a bigger discussion. And in everything that we have to do with bioethics, everything that we have to do with genomics, everything which has to do with technology is something that we have to question. Yeah. This is the second point for me that I wanted to raise. And then is question this very quick ethical answers to very specific problems without a long sided questioning about where are we heading. And the only people who can tell us are the specialists, who can tell us about the risks, or tell us about the predictive approach and what could be the consequences. Now, there is also a third point which is important, and this was said by Dr. Hadi, which is important, is that the new knowledges that we are getting now are changing our understanding of two things. The first is human beings, and second is the very essence of diseases. That sometimes we thought it was psychological, now you have people telling you, no, be careful, there are things that we can identify in the genes. It's not coming from a psychological disorder. It's not coming from a gene. It's coming from genes. So it's coming from the physical. And it means that you are changing your understanding, and even changing your understanding of human beings. When it comes, for example, where people who can identify the things that are important, even to the point that some of the recent discoveries are questioning some of the ilal that were used by scholars. Tell me, you know, for example, in neurosciences, what is said today in neurosciences, that what we said about the sensitivity of women compared to men is questionable. It might be that women are less sensitive than men, but they are more talkative. They show more, but they are more powerful. And then this is something which is an interesting question. These are neurosciences. You can discuss this. It might be wrong, it might be right. Now there are facts that are showing the brain, the way it works, is questioning some of our perceptions about the natural way we were dealing with sensitivity. It might be that these kind of things could also come to the reading of the Quran. Tell me, why in the Quran you have first, Hunna libasun lakum wa antum libasun lahum? Why is it starting with women and not with men, protecting men? It might be that the men are weaker than women. Then we read the ayah in another way, thinking that everything which has to do with testimony of woman, shahadat and mar'a, is because she's too sensitive. It might be that it has to do with knowledge, with not with sensitivity. At that time, in a very specific period of time, about traits in this situation, some of the scholars question some of our understanding of this. What I mean by this is that in genomics today, the way we are going to deal with some of the sequences that are coming from the DNA are telling us much more than what we thought about what is health and what is sickness and what is psychological. It doesn't mean that psychology is disappearing, and we have here a doctor who is dealing with this in a very specific way. It's quite the opposite. It's in fact, the more we know about the way it works, the more we understand where the psychological impact is important in the connection between the human beings and the context. So the context is very important. And then it comes to what you were saying at the end about cultures, because we have sometimes to deal with these new knowledges within the cultural context, and we have to take this into account. So this is something which is our understanding of the human being and our understanding of diseases, as it was said by Dr. Ali, meaning that we need to keep the big picture when we start talking about this technology. Now, there is a second consequence of this, is the powerful means that we have now in our hands. And what it means, powerful means, in Islam, from an akhlaqi perspective, when you have powerful means, the first thing you have to do is to question the goals, is to question, what is the goal? What do you try to do with these means? Why are you producing means? What is your intention for which objective? That's the ethical question. And the ethical question means that sometimes you have to question, you know, when I was in the European Committee of Ethics at the European level, I was talking to a British who said, you know what, in Britain, if we can do it, we are
going to do it by doing it. You can come with all your ethics. The mindset is, in our field, in science, when we can do it, we go for it. So in one way or in another. He might be wrong, because I saw many, many scholars in the UK resisting, but there is something which is important, is where do you put the ethical questions? When you have this knowledge, where, at what point, and that from an Islamic perspective, we should start with the ethical questions by questioning the means that you have now, and as you saw in our discussion. By saying what? It's first, the power that we have is to prevent, the predictive dimension, it's important. Why is it important? Because the practitioners, the ethicists, and the people who are dealing with this are going to tell us now that there are things that are predictable. There is probabilities. On this, you have to take a decision. It's there in the field. You take decision on percentages, sometimes, of the risks. So you have to. So all this, it's coming back to the power that is questioning the way we deal with our rules and the way we deal with our fatwa. The other thing is that coming with this power is that we can solve some of the problems, so we can go from the disease to the cure. And here there is something which is the principle in Islam that was even said by Muslim scholars when it came to cloning, is therapy by definition is right and we go for it. Now we are balancing between what could be dealing with the risks, knowing that this is as a therapy, so we go for it. But there is a third dimension here that is coming out of this discussion, which is فَلْيُغَيِّرُونَ خَلْقَ اللَّهِ. So the dimension here is about changing. And it's true now that by knowing the way our genomes are and the sequence, there is a power to interfere, to enter. We knew this with genetics before, but now the sequence is when you interfere. Is it for therapy, therapeutical reasons, or is it with other intentions? And when you know today the way the pharmaceutical company are working, you can't trust their good intentions. You can't do that. So this is why you have to come with the big picture. And sometimes the ulama, the fuqaha, are coming to something which is taking the decision in a void when it comes to the context, and not knowing always what are the contradictory trends that are working for other reasons, with other intentions, to make money much more than to think about therapy. And let me tell you, give you an example, the way the pharmaceutical companies dealt with AIDS around the world is insane. Insane, knowing that they were killing people. So when it comes to the Muslim majority countries where we have such power, we need to know with whom we are dealing. So predictive, it's important. To cure and to solve the problems, it's essential, and we go for it. And now we also have to understand what could be the consequences when it comes to changing. And we had, I was sitting with the Sheikh this morning when he touched upon this reference, the misunderstanding of the verse, of this reference of changing the creation. And this is something that, once again, we have to talk about when it comes to this. The third thing that is coming out of the new knowledge is what you were saying, which is important. When it comes to genomics, we are working on two different dimensions. So, like an ijabi. What I was saying. Yes, you said something which is important. When it comes to genomics, we are dealing with two different levels. We are dealing with populations, so we are mapping, in a way, something that could have a consequence with people. It's important. And even within specific tribes, within specific societies, in knowing the risk, so it could be very positive, but could have very, very negative impacts, the way it could be used within a society. And then it comes to individuals, it comes to what was said in dealing with individuals and trying to get the understanding of this genome sequence. Going as far as something that could be really a tremendous progress when it comes to medicine is this personal drug for you, and to do something which is completely adapted to the people. So this is huge. Now you understand that if you go as far as this, it means that you are coming to one of the things that you are saying, it's equality. Equality when it comes to health is where are we going, how are we going to distribute this? So there are two problems here. Distributing knowledge, which is making the people aware, which is a right, I have the right to know, and then also to have access to this, I have also the right to be protected. So it could be a means that is going to be used by the rich to protect themselves, but expose the poor not to be protected when it comes to knowledge and when it comes to the use of this technology today. And as it was said, I think it's quite important to think about the psychological impact, the social impact. So these are points, and let me just raise some of the points that I think when it comes to Islamic ethics we have to deal with. As I was saying, we need to get this big picture, and we need to question some of way of reading the scriptural sources. And it's not new. It's not new. It's from the our understanding of the world, the universe. You know, for example, when we are starting Ramadan, Al-Hilal, and the moon, is your eyes a mabda or is it a wasila? Because now you can see it, the astrophysician can give you a picture of when Al-Hilal is now. You have in exactly when it happens. So some are saying, no, ru'ya lain. So this is mabda, it's not al-wasila. And others saying, no, it might. So this is questioning our way of reading. So this is in the big picture. It's exactly the same about the visible. Now we can see the visible with genes, and we can get things that we didn't know before, and we have to take decisions here. So in fact, l'ikhtilaf on this, it's acceptable, but at one point it becomes problematic. It becomes problematic. Because today we don't know how to deal with time, we don't know how to deal with al-qamar. So what about the genes? What about the genes? So there are things here that are, this diversity also is always welcome, but at one point that we need to have also something which is a bit more courageous about questioning some of the readings in such a way. I think that this has to do with al-akhlaq. The second is what I said, no way for us today, and this is something that is new for the ulama, it's new for all of us. I have to, yes. It's given to me, where I took too much time, or it's a gift. So, okay, just to know if you are giving me a gift. What I said at the beginning is the new methodology. It's, in fact, I'm convinced that it's through these experiences that we have with medicine, with genomics, with genetics, that we feel, all of us, when we are dealing with this and we are just dealing with medical doctors or geneticists, that we are in dire need of a new methodology. And this new methodology is based on transdisciplinary approach. Transdisciplinary approach is, I'm sorry to all the people who are working in fiqh here, they need to be connected to all the other human sciences and experimental sciences, because this is too much. We can't just go for it and just try to catch up with the West. The power of the dominant is not only to dominate you, it's to push you to decide the way you are going to catch up with them. So to decide the way you are going to come to the question by putting some pressure on some essential questions. And I think that we, in fact, just have also to deal with what is happening in the West. One of the great problems in the West is this fragmentation of knowledge. This is where ethics is lost. The only way to bring ethics at the center is transdisciplinary, it's comprehensive. And in this is what we need, because all what, you know, when I was sitting with people from the state here, or from the state in Switzerland, in the way they deal with this, it's very dangerous. It's very dangerous because they ask you to be right in a very fragmented area and to give an ethical answer, and you understand that the big picture is lost if we don't go for interdisciplinary. The third thing was about what you said about the rights, and I think that once again we have to come to this, because at the end of the day, when we are saying وَلَقَدْ كَرَّمْنَا بَنِي آدَمَ, when we are saying إِنَّ خَلَقْنَاكُمْ مِنْ ذَكَرٍ وَأُنْثَى, the unity of humanity, this should start in
majority Muslim countries as something which is a principle that we are not going to use the new technologies in the way that you are supporting the rich and forget about the poor. And then also the reality of the way we deal with migrants in this society. These are all questions that are connected to this. The national preference or the national could be understandable, but still it has to be questioned in the name of our ethics. The fourth point that I wanted to say very quickly is the consequences of this use, the use of this knowledge. And once again, I just want to raise this question. These are come from the big picture to smaller questions or more detailed questions about this definition of health and weakness. And there is another thing which is important when it comes to Islam and when it comes with the way you deal with people is about security and control. Genomes and genomics has to do with controlling people, controlling population, and could be a way of controlling, not in only in the way that you are mapping, and it's also something where you can have an understanding of the way it works, so you can, in the name of security, push to take some decisions that could have an impact on the ethical implementation. And the last question is about, when do we stop? Do we have the right to stop? Do we have an ethical duty here to say we better stop on this because the consequences are harming much more than the benefit that we have? So to set a methodology is something that is important. Our ulama and the shuyukh here, we had it in our discussion in the center, need also to have this big picture and ready to change our understanding of some of the principles or the priorities in Islam in the way we deal with all the sciences all together. And with all this, we come here with some of the questions that were put, where we are dealing as Muslims with very specific questions that were put by Dr. Ghali and common questions that are put by all the societies. So we are between these common questions that we have to tackle and these very specific questions when it comes to marriage, when it comes to personal cure, when it comes, for example, for my right to know what I have and how I'm going to get this. And the last point is this one. With genomics today, which was so expensive in the past, and you can see now that for $1,000 you can get your... now, there is something which is reaching the people. How are we going to do something which is not only it's important to speak about Islamic ethics, but in Islamic ethics that are something which is ethical is to inform the people. One of the main problems that we have with ulama today is that they think as specialists, but they are not reaching the people. And this is so great and so powerful and so risky as the consequences that we need now to re-question the relationship between ulama and people. Because your duty is to answer the people. Your duty is to be closer to the questions because I have the right to know. So if I have the right to know, don't think about your ethical answers only in the way I deal with medicine, but the way I deal with patients. So it might be that one of our questions when it comes to genomics is to have ethics of the patient and not the ethics of the tabib only. The doctors, the patients, is how do we deal with this? And this is where the fuqaha should also be quite instrumental. Wallahu
a'lam. Thank you very much. Before giving the word, before giving the word to Professor Yassin, there is a mistake I've done which I shouldn't have done. That's thanking the Supreme Council of Health for collaborating with us on this issue, on this panel, and thanking specifically and personally Dr. Iman Saadun for her great help and dedicated support to making this panel happen. We have been through many difficulties, and I believe without her support, it wouldn't have been possible to hear together. So thank you very much, and thanks for the collaboration. And now,
in the name of God, the most compassionate, the most merciful, May the peace of God and blessings be upon his prophet and his companions. First of all, I would like to thank the organizers of this very important meeting. I would like to thank the Supreme Council of Health, and particularly Dr. Iman Saadoun. And I would like also to thank Kyle, the Center for Islamic Legislation and Ethics. I would like to thank Dr. Mohammed Ghali, before the director of the center. I would like to thank him for organizing this seminar and for presenting the questions that we are supposed to answer and to prepare. So, I have a number of introductions also. I know that you've exerted a great effort, and you are very tired as a result of organizing this event. So my colleagues in the panel have presented their interventions. So my intervention is going to be different. I am not a medical doctor. I am not specialized in any of these medical fields or scientific fields. That is why I'm going to talk about a different perspective about the methodology that should be used in scientific research, because we would like our medical doctors to perhaps benefit from the methodology that I'm going to refer to here. First of all, so we would like to talk about the benefits, and some people when talking about benefits, they say there is no benefits. So many people, they say there is nothing, no benefits. They do that because when they give you a little bit, then you would be very thankful. So Dr. Ghali called me a month ago and invited me to come and talk about this issue. And I told him that I don't know much. I know nothing about this field. I haven't conducted any research in this field. I heard of this field, but I know nothing tangible about the field. He said, we would like you to read a number of research papers and maybe to come up with a kind of a general opinion, not a detailed opinion. So, in this intervention, I'm going to talk about the general ideas about this field, and I'm going to give a number of observations. That is why the paper that I'm presenting, I called it Observations, because I cannot improvise. That is why I have written my paper here. So I warn you, I might forget certain things. So when I have an intervention, I call them, I have 5 points I would like to mention. I'm going to forget 3 of the 5, and I'm going to give you 2 of the 5 points. And perhaps I would be reminded by the help, with the help of God. And I would like to thank God for that. That is why I'm going to, from time to time, I'm going to look at the paper in front of me. So this is another introduction. So I'm going to talk about this topic and how to conduct research in this topic, and how doctors present the information to the religious scholars. So I think both parties, the scholars, the medical scholars and the religious scholars, do not give enough. So we're going to mention certain evidence about that. And this is a very dangerous issue. It is different from other topics, such as the definition of death in Islamic Sharia or other topics. So this is not a simple topic. It is a very intricate topic. So I would like also to say if my colleagues decided to speak in a foreign language in a society that is in a society in which 90% of people understand Arabic, for me to be able to give you an opinion in Sharia, you have to explain to me things in the Arabic language. And if you cannot do so, so do not expect me to answer you. Do not expect me to give you any answers. If you give something that you cannot explain, so how can I conceptualize things and tell you that this is haram or halal, this is allowed or not allowed, permissible or not permissible, if I don't understand it in the first place? The interpreter, the two interpreters, they have translated the content of your intervention. They did a good job. So if you want to give us information, would you do that through interpreters or would you translate the material? Those, some people translated the book for me about Iman, and they made so many mistakes in English and French. I did understand your interventions. So please talk to us through interpreters. We would like you, those who want to, who have love for ethics and for their religion, to be good speakers of the Arabic language and be able to give a kind of a simplified translation of their interventions. We're not seeking complicated translations of medical texts, as it is the case in some papers. We would like things to be simplified. We would like the medical doctors to simplify their terminology, to simplify the concepts to the religious scholars. If they do not simplify matters and things to religious scholars, the ruling would not be correct. So these are all introductions that I thought I should talk about before I start my intervention. There's something that we tend to forget sometimes. When corruption prevails, all the questions, all what we say would be of no help. I would like to ask you,
من يذهب إلى مختبر أو إلى طبيب أو
How many of you have gone to a visited a doctor or gone to a laboratory to extract some blood from them? All of us have done so. So how can I be sure of what is taking place? We need legislations. We should to put an end to corruption. We talked about the insurance companies and other companies. Also, they talked about organ donation and that we should control organ donation. Some said that organ donation should not be permissible because there are some gangs who are taking advantage of organ donation. So I told them, if we say that organ donation is haram, is not permissible, is this going to put an end to these gangs? No, it will not. These gangs will continue, will remain, but we need to have restrictions. So any person can conduct research. I mean, to conduct research, you just need a small amount, let's say a small drop of blood. Our patients, they go to doctors, and doctors can extract whatever they want. And who is going to control that? We need to control that through legislations and regulations. We need people to control what is taking place. We need to have effective procedures. So it is necessary to conduct research in this field because it is a very, very important field. We would like to have the legislations, adequate legislations and regulations. This is one thing. So sometimes religious scholars are very tentative or unwilling to give juristic rulings. We wait for the outcomes of these sciences to come to us from the West. Sometimes, because we are waiting for these sciences and results to come from the West. So why wouldn't we try to plant such sciences, try to use these sciences in Arab and Muslim countries? I think this is a duty. It is on the whole ummah, on rulers. All of them are supposed to do so. So I felt that it was necessary for me to give these introductions. Dr. Muhammad Ghali said that the contemporary intellect is facing difficulties in dealing with the genome from a jurisprudence perspective. And the question, why do we have these difficulties when it comes to the human genome, and what are the methodologies and things that we have agreed upon, and the other issues that require more research? So this is the point that I started from. So why are we facing difficulties in this particular topic? Because this is a very dangerous topic. It has to do with the genes. And It has many repercussions. It can lead to opening the door or closing the door altogether. It can lead to many benefits, or it can lead to many harms. If you close the door all together, not allow the use of such science, it can lead to harms. It can lead, to harms. And if you open it altogether, it can also bring benefits and maybe some harms. So when we read the benefits, we would say that we have to keep such a science and encourage such a science, but those who read the harms and negative impacts of such science, they would say, let's not deal with this science. So this is a very, very dangerous topic. It is more deranged than any other medical topic. It is very branched out. It is very intricate. And it can lead to many issues when it comes to the diagnostic side or therapeutic side or transplant side. And because it has to do also with the al-aqidah, with the behavior, because if what they say is right or proves to be right, that these mutagens would control us, we, men and women, we become robotic. And this is not in parity with al-aqidah. But this topic requires a great deal of research, especially when it comes to aqidah and to behavior and the intervention of the state. This topic requires the intervention of the state more than any other topics. So this project would make the religious scholar to be very tentative, many questions to pose. Some of the scholars mentioned that they allowed that in the United States, and then they stopped it for 3 years, and after that they decided to continue with the field with certain number of restrictions, and the restrictions were very good indeed. So these are the exporting countries, and sometimes they fear the side effects of such projects. The second point, and this point has to do with the topic that we are dealing with and the ethical side of the topic. We do not know the impacts of this science in human life. That is why we have to be patient. I have read the research paper by Mohammed Fathallah. And in his paper, he did not try to interfere in the capacity of other religious scholars. And I read the recommendations of the Islamic Council, and it included three papers by specialized people, and others by people specialized in Sharia.
And here we see now some sort of an overlap. The Sharia scholars saying something which implies that it's of a medical nature and vice versa. Some people come to you asking for a certain edict, in a matter relating to medicine, maybe one word here, one word there, an addition of one word, an introduction of one word, can make it closer to Sharia and make it more Sharia compatible in that case. So what is even more dangerous is what people talk about, the implications of the genes and the behavior of human beings and how it's inherited from one generation to another, and it can be interfered with or influenced. And then what can we do vis-a-vis such a concept if we allow people to be subjected to this kind of intervention? What will the consequences be? We need more research on that. In my opinion, we want the scholars to explain to us the relationship between the genes and the human mind, the human intellect. In Islamic Sharia, the brain is the king of the body and not the spirit or the soul, because it sends signals and receives signals and to govern the behavior of human beings. And how the brain transmits to the organs of the body and how it receives signals from them, similar to what they say about software and hardware. If, for example, if you send to my soul or my brain the wrong signal, for example, whether we're talking from the point of view of philosophy or psychology, maybe this can be explained in Sharia, and there is and maybe it's the genome which is sending these signals. These are things we have not yet understood. If we understand them, we can tell you, for example, the psychological diseases and psychiatric diseases. Can doctors interfere, for example, to treat things like hallucinations or depression or the like through the genes? There are many, many examples of this. I finished 5 minutes and I have 25 remaining, or is it the other way around? Okay, this is an important matter, and I think the very seriousness of this matter should make us not deal with it in a hurry. We must be patient. You really must give us enough information which can enable us to give you the proper answers. There is another important point, and I'm talking about our doctors, our physicians, and their responsibility comes before the Sharia scholars. And by that I mean we lack terribly in the information. Dr. Muhammad Ghali said there should be means and ways of measuring the results and measuring people, measuring behavior and action. I'm told this is a science on its own, and there are many books and a lot of research papers which make things measurable, and information and data which indicate how this kind of measurement can be done, and the assessment of the pros and cons. Also, in Islamic jurisprudence, we have something similar about the future prospects, the consequences, and therefore it's very common, you see, that the perceived or projected harm carries the same weight as an actual harm. So therefore we must use some form of scientific ways of measuring that, to see if we interfere from the point of view of genomics or not. What will happen if we close the door altogether? What will happen? And what will happen if we open the door? I cannot answer to that because I'm not an expert. You as an expert, you have to specify to me the pros and cons, the negatives and the positives, and then according to that I can weigh up and judge, and in view of the prime objectives of Sharia. If you do not give me a sound way of measuring this, I will not be able to give you an answer, because I cannot myself determine whether this is a harm or an interest being achieved or a good being achieved. And also, I think it's safe to say that our brothers, the scholars of science and medicine, are mixing reality and projections, and they have not given us, the Sharia scholars, the determined result, proper results, definite results, to enable us to measure. So I have to measure all of these things, what is perceived, what is actual, what is projected, and what is a reality, etc., etc. All of these things, the considerations I have to take. And okay, if now that you're tired, you're laughing, it seems. Yes, fatwa or an edict is totally reliant on the evidence it's being presented in its favor or against it. For example, if you give a tailor a small piece of cloth, he will tell you this is not enough to measure a full dress. You have to give me more. There are some established things I can respond to, but I cannot, for example, when I hear research saying that only the number of people who have received genetic treatment is in the tens and scores and not hundreds or thousands, and some of them have even died in the process as a result of that. How am I supposed to, in that case, come with a decision? Because for me, as a jurisprudent expert or scholar, I have to determine that the pros outweigh the cons, and the benefit far exceeds the harm expected. So therefore, in that case, you have to be able to measure, you have to have the information, you have to have the data, the assessment. So in a nutshell, I'm still in the fourth point here, so therefore the competent experts, specialists, should have the initiative here and should provide us the information and formulating the questions too, which correspond to all the side issues branching out from the central theme. And people should, maybe I'm wrong, don't laugh at me. If you want to laugh, laugh secretly, please. So, laugh secretly, please, because maybe what I say is something which is not clear enough for me, I'm inquiring about, and when, which may sound strange to others, and they consider it as a laughing matter. This is what I don't mean, don't laugh at me, I mean, don't laugh at the questions, and don't, so that people do not think you're ridiculing the inquisition behind all of this. There is a lot of mystery shrouding these issues, really. There's a lot of vagueness. There is a lot of talk, but the hard evidence is still scarce. Is there really a relationship between, for example, psychological things, disorders, and the genome? Can we separate a gene, for example, and save a person from depression or other disorders? I have not come across anything that, even with some viruses that are treated with other viruses, I don't know how to explain this. When the sound gene enters the body, it does not go to the other cells or things. Have they managed to create or separate such a gene which can target specific cells and disregard others, for example? And what was the percentage of that likelihood? This is what matters to me. Please give me this information. And also, you talked about variants and things like that. But why do genes get these illnesses, really? What are the reasons? What are the causes? Can we prevent that? Can genetic disorders be prevented? These are the kind of questions we want to know so that we can tell you the conditions and the exceptions, the procedures that can be taken by the state or, for example, or the competent authorities. So therefore, people with very, very far specialists, people who seem to be experts, but not like of the highest degree of, for example, some people specialize in genetics in general, but they're not specifically, for example, are experts in a certain field with a lot of fine focus and finely tuned focusing on something. I don't want general practitioners, so to speak. Of course, I'm not here to ban people from thinking or making research or writing, but I'm asking for something more specific. People, the actual real experts who can give you the kind of information, because in Islamic jurisprudence, passing a judgment on something is derived and dependent on how you perceive it or understand it. If you perceive it and understand it properly, you will give the proper answer, and the opposite is true. So therefore, I'm not here judging other people or assessing their abilities. I'm only demanding a precondition of specific information and data, because this is something very important for me as a a jurisprudent, and in Islam, this is a duty incumbent upon the experts, and they should, but they are duty bound by Islamic Sharia to do this work, to serve other people, to enjoin what's good, and disregard what is bad and harmful. The Allah Almighty orders the scholars to explain things to people, and also this is equivalent to giving a witness before court when you call to give your statement before a judge. If you do not do that, then you're liable to be punished, and God Almighty makes it a duty upon people, and your witness statement has to be like a proper eyewitness, not hearsay, for example. And this should take into account total honesty and objectivity, even if the person you are providing your statement is a Muslim or a non-believer. It makes no difference. You have to, this is a principle of Sharia, you have to do your job and duty and act. Do I still have 10 minutes? Okay. Also, now we turn our attention to jurisprudence. You can laugh now. Maybe jurisprudents are criticized for their hasty decisions, for example, on passing opinions on a matter which is not yet finally settled by the experts in the field. And I've read something about this, really. So we have to be careful here, and we have to wait until the matter is settled and sorted out finally, and then a jurisprudent can. Until then, the door to ijtihad and passing opinion will remain open. For example, when it comes to donating kidneys, for example, if someone can genetically produce an artificial kidney which is good enough and small enough as the human kidney people can buy, then there'll be no need for donating kidneys. Then if we have similarly have hearts and corneas and kidneys, for example, then the jurisprudence will have to pass different judgments at the time. For example, when it comes to the definition of death, the definition of death for Islamic jurisprudence is close to the definition of the brain dead case by doctors, when someone's brain no longer functions and the rest of the body is more or less considered. But although there are differences in what we can call the British school of thought or the American school of thought on the signs, on the vital signs of life or death, for example, we have to settle the matter first and say, this is final. These are the signs which will determine whether a person is brain dead or not. Then, after that, and only then, you can reach a verdict, so to speak, from a jurisprudence point of view. Otherwise, the question will remain open to different inputs and interpretations. So therefore, scientific circles, research and conferences. I remember in 1980 I wrote extensively on this, but now things are different. Now doctors have changed their opinion. As I said, we go back to the question of the piece of cloth and how we design it and cut it according to our size, our measurements. Also, Sharia scholars can be criticized also in the way they view things. I don't mean here the way they look at things, their eyesight. I mean here their insight, rather, if we can call it that. And sometimes there is inactivity in, for example, some people interpret a certain verse in the Quran, which Allah Almighty says about some people who change the creation of Allah, and they interpret that to say that the genetic engineering amounts to that. I don't agree with that. What the ayah means is different. I have no time to delve into much detail about that. But what is the opinion that most experts agree on, that what is meant by the creation of that is the pristine condition God creates human beings, and in other words, their religion, their state of mind is here, was meant here, and not the actual bodily creations or something. And the way of life that God has chosen for humanity, and we were informed by that through His messenger when Allah Almighty said, for example, do this and don't do that, don't cheat in this, don't misinform. These are artificial issues, the changes, some changes are obligatory in Islam. Some commentaries on the Quran, which has been published here in Qatar, and Ibn Atiyah, for example, who Ibn Taymiyyah says is the best, is better than Zamakhshari's interpreter, and Ibn Khaldun also praised, he said Ibn Atiyah, Suyuti called him the role model for all commentators on the Quran. So therefore, his opinion of interpreting this verse, in conclusion, he says that any harmful change is the result of what Satan wants, and therefore is not permissible, and any change which is positive and of benefit, then it's permissible. I say not only permissible, but it's obligatory, it's dutiful, we should do that, because like, for example, when Allah Almighty creates a disease, then this is part of God's creation. So if we start changing in that, this is, for example, our duty to do so. So therefore, this question of changing is there's the question of predestined orders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which will never be changed. And there are other things which we are ordered to change and not accept as they are. For example, when sometimes when Allah predestines or predetermines something, it will always happen, but maybe it's 0 minutes I have. Okay, the 5 minutes are over, so therefore using this verse is not applicable here. It's very artificial and hollow. And also some doctors some Sharia experts and some doctors are really go beyond the realm of competence and start meddling in other things, and some doctors started passing religious edicts, and some religious scholars are passing opinions on medical matters. I only understood this matter by a little bit. That's all. I cannot now claim to be an expert in it, so I need the opinions of the expert. The terminology is very difficult. I don't understand many of them. People should exert the effort for the sake of Allah to simplify these matters to people, to inform people, to clarify things for them. You are duty bound. Allah orders you to decimate this knowledge and explain it, because this is a matter that cannot be dealt with by anybody. These are specific, specialized matters, should be examined carefully by real, qualified experts, and for example, what Dr. Muhammad Ali may have said in the question of what is beneficiary or benefit or interest, when, for example, if of the benefit outweighs the harm, then this is permissible. Of course, we cannot just use that in its absolute terms generally. Sometimes there are things which are a bit complicated and some much simpler. For example, if we take sometimes doctors use the verse that God Almighty created man in its best form. Some people say human beings are God's best creation because God created them and injected life into him or her and gave him sight and all the other things. So if genes can do something to improve this, why can't we benefit from that? Some people say, yes, but God says changing is not allowed. Okay, it may not be allowed in some aspects, but if change enhances the ability to see better, to hear better, for example, why can't we do that? If we can find a way to enhance the human sight, for example, why do not we do that? So we have to understand beforehand what are we allowed to change or not. God created the humans as being able to think, to speak, to see, to hear, etc. So if we enhance these abilities and senses and others, what's the harm in that? This is not the kind of change which is harmful, after all. So therefore, it's important to understand these things. For example, if we can make human beings stronger, I'm sitting here, I'm here arguing out with you the methodology. I don't know, I may end up concluding that this will not be or should not be permissible, but at least there we, in the methodology, we must understand that some change can be of benefit. And there are things like, for example, treating diseases and illnesses. And also, if there is something which will benefit the community at large, if there is sometimes the question of personal freedom and the question of the secrecy and privacy and things that if someone told you to not to spell out the details of my genome. So, for example, because if you say something about that, if you reveal it before people who can be, but sometimes in Sharia, for example, you own a piece of land which is your private property, and if you want to build a house that will harm and, for example, stop the flow of water or air to other farmers, the Sharia will not allow you to build there, although it's your own privately owned property. The state can interfere. For example, not every freedom is a freedom which should be treated as that. Sometimes there are things which can benefit the community, and the state can interfere in against your freedom for the benefit of the public good. I'm here just discussing with you. I'm not saying I'm judging these things one way or another. I'm not saying this is allowed and this is not. There is a lot of things. How much time do you have now? There are also some questions on the methodology. علينا أن ننتهي في التاسعة ونعطي بعض الوقت الأسئلة. Anyway, the paper, you have the paper, you can publish it. There are things which were raised, but I did not respond to whether or not there are things which are now are agreed upon and there is unanimity on them. For example, in Sharia, when different scholars of the Islamic Ummah from different parts and countries agree on in principle, this is something which is taken into account. But sometimes people just pass judgments, so-called judgments, on whimsical trends rather than proper evidence. We cannot call that an agreement or unanimity or consensus scientifically. There is also do you want me to talk about reaching consensus on, like, for example, the Jurisprudence Council reached agreement on? I don't have time, of course, but there are recommendations which can make people can refer on how human being or human behavior is interfered with and changed genetically. This is something we have to refer to medical texts and psychological texts and other sources of information. Also, there are some Islamic jurists have laid down some rules on how to deal with the question of genomes, how to apply the balancing out between harm and good. I read an excellent paper, or it was a thesis actually. Somebody I supervised is an excellent, which really simplifies the objectives of the prime objectives of Sharia. The scientific methodology on the question of insanity, for example, insanity, these are very important. How Sharia deals with that? What methodology does Sharia require to deal with such cases? And also, what authority can the state or should the state have to interfere in the genome project? Also, what rules can or conditions can be applied on the question of dealing with information, for example? For example, if the state does a survey on children and discovers that certain children are not the biological sons of their fathers and do not belong to a certain tribe, the Prophet, may Allah's blessings be upon him, says clearly that the parenthood or something that should be determined, and the biological, for example, parenthood and fatherhood. So we need some information on this, apart from just publishing information or disseminating it. Also, when we talk about other questions which are raised in the media in general, and how these technologies can be applied in the Muslim world with the Sharia's opinion. Finally, I thank Almighty God for granting me the ability to come here and speak before you. I thank you for the kind attention, and may the blessings of God be upon you. Now we open the floor for questions and answers. Please, this is your time now. Just raise your hands if you have any questions so that we can judge how many people we can allow for the time we have.
Microphone, please. رجاء استخدام ميكروفون. ميكروفون رجاء. One seminar or one fatwa or one religious scholar can solve any issues pertaining to genome sequencing. So there are certain simple things that they are clear that they are halal, and some other things that are clear that they are not permissible. Maybe in this seminar we could have concentrated on one particular thing, maybe the random sequencing of the human genome, maybe try to look into one particular population. In that case, we could have tried to depict one particular issue. So it is very clear if the cure that we're going to find is going to be beneficial, then it is going to be permissible. And if it is not going to be beneficial, then it is not going to be permissible. Now, the insulin that used to be made from human components, now it is made of genomic sources. So I think that this seminar is very broad as a title, but I would like to comment about what Dr. Mohammed Naimi Yassin said. Are the genomes specify everything, identify everything? There was something that Dr. Hatim was supposed to answer, but I'm going to comment on it. Yes, we as populations, we are born with certain genomes, but the environment changes us, especially when it comes to immunity. So these are inherited components that we are born with, but as a result of the impact of the environment, it can lead to different reactions from one person to another. So children, especially if they are brothers and sisters, their genes can be changed as a result of the environment that they are exposed to, and you will find the reaction differ even between these brothers and sisters, between themselves, and they change from one cell to another. So science cannot say and identify that the genome are the answer to everything. It is the environment, it is the behavior, human behavior, the different illnesses, and so on and so forth. All of them identify the situation. So we have some illnesses that we are, have susceptible to get or to be inflicted with due to X and Y factors. So this is a very, very broad topic, and it requires a lot of discussion. So we're going to take the questions first, and then we're going to open the floor for the answers by the different scholars. In the name of God, the most compassionate, Mohammed Mukhtar, student at the college here. I would like to thank you for the nice lectures. This is going to open the scope about future discussions, but there are a number of issues that we have to take into account, such as preordainment, predestination, patience, to be thankful. Some say that to be cured is better than to be inflicted and to be patient. So some of them, they say, I would prefer to be cured than thank God. And some others would say, no, I would prefer to be inflicted than to be patient. So we still have some problematic issues when it comes to these concepts. And these concepts should be solved, because some people would think about infliction as a means of being patient and showing thankfulness to God as a result of their patience, that they are pleased and ready to accept what they have been inflicted with. So, because of the fact that I work with people with disabilities, I think we have to sit with this category of people, because so many fatwas that have been issued would change as a result of sitting with these people, because there's so many things that we do not understand. And we have to understand also that there are certain regions, certain areas, and certain countries that impede development of such kind of sciences. So because of the presence of so many traditional old ideas. Does anybody of you have a question to Dr. Tariq, because he needs to leave? You have a question to Dr. Tariq? Go ahead. So I have a question and a comment. Mahmoud Mbayed, consultant in psychology. I would like to thank all the speakers, the center and Dr. Tariq and Dr. Ghali. I read a while ago about the history of the discovery and invention of the telephone. If you read the newspapers at the time, because people were very much fearful of such kind of invention, they used to say that this is going to be very much inimical to society. And look at now, we all of us have telephones in our pockets. And the Islamic organization has invited 20 to 25 Sharia scholars and 20 to 25 medical doctors. That was 9 or 10 years ago. And they try to hold research in genetic engineering. That was 15 years ago. Oh. So I think we have retreated. Genetic science has made so many advances. So why wouldn't we work on what has been researched and maybe try to revisit the things that have been reached, as Dr. Yassin has said. Medicine has developed a great deal. In the past, we used to wait for the first diagnosis and also and now with the CT scan, we can, before we see the first traits of the medical situation, we can come up with the solution. So any invention should be paralleled by an ethical dimension. So before, nomads did not have ethics of neighborhood because they remained nomads and they were moving from one place to another. But when people stabilized and settled in one particular area, they developed what we call ethics of dealing with neighborhood. In Ireland, I lived there 30 years, and people, they had alternatives. So we have to look also at the Islamic alternative and what's the jurists say and what the religious scholars say, because that would be a means that would lead us to finding alternatives and solutions. My question to Dr. Tariq Ramadan, and also it is a recommendation to the center, when we try to see the relationship between Islam and any of the sciences, we go back to the usul and the principles. So I would like that this center would do two things. We should, stop dealing with this relationship between the two. So we have to also understand the different competent parties. We have to understand the different people who are specialized in the different fields. So we're going to give the floor to Dr. Tariq Ramadan. Islam and Islamic values and maqasid and Islamic principles, there should be a relationship between these principles and the different sciences. Going back to Islamic heritage is a principle, but I think such a relationship is very important indeed for us to be able to give something. When it comes to Islamic ethics and to give an Islamic perspective, this is necessary and we cannot do without it. So what is important in this discourse is the methodology, how to deal with the Islamic ethics and non-Islamic ethics. So it is the methodology that is very important now. We at the center, we try to find the relationship between the scholars of the text and scholars of the context and try to understand the ethical dimensions and also the maqasid, because we would like Muslims to give something in this field to contribute to the discussion that is taking place now in the field of science. what I meant, I didn't say we shouldn't go back to the principles and to a maqasid. But if we have, let's say, an event after 1 month about the relationship between Islam and astrology, I would like to thank Dr. Mohammed Naim Nasin and about the points that he talked about. But I have a problem. I have a problem with the methodology. I would like to discuss the methodology. Maybe we should have a seminar dealing with the methodology. It is not only the values and the principles. It is understanding the sciences and the relationship between these sciences and the sources. Should we talk about the scripture and the relationship between these scriptures and the reality? So I like what you're saying. Yes, I like what you're saying. So let's have one seminar for that particularly. So we'll take more questions. In the name of God, the most compassionate. Al-Sharia al-Maqasid, some of the religious scholars have defined these Maqasid, and we can summarize their definition by saying that God has issued revelations for people to be on the right path. So if people are on the right path, everything would be fine. Because human beings, when they are inflicted with bad things, they don't like it. Unless you're a believer in God, that is why we have to be on the right path. And to be on the right path, we have to have ethics, we have to have morals. Once you have ethics and morals, you would be on the right path. So if these ethics and morals are no longer existent, all what we deal with would lead to harm. So throughout our lives, we have to care about ethics. So the more ethical we are, all these topics around us would be good. But once we do not apply ethics and morals, as it is our case today in our world, people would use these ethics in order to implement or do things that are amoral, that are not ethical. Assalamu alaikum. I would like to thank you for your effort, but I have got a small observation. When you entered to the seminar, were you expecting that all people present here know everything about the genome? We would expecting that you would simplify things, because haven't you simplified these things? We wouldn't be able to understand what is taking place. I came to the seminar with very small information, very limited information about the genome, and I'm leaving this seminar with no added information. And I'm now going to resort to the internet to get information for me to be able to write something about this seminar. You are talking about facts and figures and investments as if we are going to invest in the fields. I would like to thank you for your efforts, but I would like you to pay heed to this point in the future, because where does raising awareness start from? So for us to understand, we have to understand the process itself. Once we understand understand the process, then as a result of that, we're going to decide whether we're going to have this procedure or not. If you do not understand, we cannot have the procedure. So you have posed so many ethical and philosophical questions. Were you expecting us to be able to answer your questions? Was your aim to raise awareness, or was your aim to terrorize us and make us really scared? I do not know whether I'm supposed to write about the topic or not to write about the topic. So the question, shall we have more research in the field? I do not know what the objective of this seminar. I have entered this seminar not knowing so many things, and I'm leaving the seminar still not knowing so many things. May the peace of God be upon you. Thank you very much. I have got a PhD in genetic engineering, and I'm participating with Dr. Al-Qaradaghi. I present the scientific side, and he presents the juristic side. So I would like to ask Dr. Yassin, do you have any advice to raise awareness of the jurist, for him to pose the adequate questions? Because you said people who are competent, who are specialized, are the ones who are supposed to give information. I know that the information is very broad, but we should have a methodology from the part of the jurists, because they have to be able to choose the adequate questions that should be posed, because we do not want the scientists to enter into details that would not be helpful in the fatwa that he or she is going to issue. Thank you very much. Based on the opinions of others, I would like to ask, with the development, the speedy development that we see, it is not realistic to think that the religion would respond comprehensively to all the questions that are being posed in science. Sometimes there are some applications of science that are going to be very positive, and at the same time there are some other applications that would have negative repercussions. So how can we retrieve the creative spirit that used to be available during our old and past scholars, especially when it comes to complex issues? How can we overcome certain philosophical issues and to be able to join the West, because we do not want just to apply what they have reached? How can we use religion in a manner that would make us stronger as Muslims, as opposed to the weakness that we live today? May the peace of God be upon you. From my humble opinion, I think in the next 10 years, the whole world, including Muslims, are going to develop a great deal in the different sciences. And I think if the jurists do not join such developments, if the religious scholars should join this train of science, if they do not do so, they would be marginalized as a result of that. So we do need jurists who are scientists at the same time. And I agree with what Aisha has said. I have entered the seminar knowing nothing about the topic, and I still do not know anything about the topic. Yes, there is a gap between science and ethics. So who is responsible to decide about changing the creation of God? Is it the scientists or is it the jurists? So there are a number of questions that have been posed, talking about the nature of the seminar and trying to answer questions about the genome. So this topic was posed in one of our meetings in the Supreme Council of Health, and we proposed that we should start with a seminar to know the most important questions that should be discussed afterwards. This is just a kind of a start-off seminar that's from which we're going to decide the path that we're going to take for us to be able to answer future questions. The aim was not to answer all questions. This is impossible, and I said that in the introduction. So if you have many questions in your mind, that means that you're going to come back to find answers to these questions. So the rest of the questions, I'm going to give 5 minutes to each and every panelist, and after that we're going to close this seminar. Thank you.
First, I will respond in Arabic, otherwise Dr. Mohammed Naeem Yassin will tell me off for laughing. I'm extremely happy when the two sisters said that they came here not knowing much and they're departing with more or less the same thing. What we talked about here is not the actual science, is what we talked about some techniques and things which we'll encounter in the near future in our communities. Soon enough, you will go to your doctor and he will say to you, go and get me your genome. Then you will start thinking about the kind of questions that we have raised here. So I'm very happy that you are raising such questions, because this kind of questions and many other similar to this, we are not talking about genetic engineering. We do not want to meddle the issues. What we're talking about here is a kind of a test which will produce a result called the genome, which is something being dealt with now in Western countries and countries outside the Muslim world, or non-Arab countries, non-Middle Eastern countries. This is something which is more or less widely spread now in those countries. And some things are population-based, some are individualized. So if we do not come up with this kind of questions, try and find some sort of, maybe, I do not want to call it conditions or rules, but maybe some sort of directions. This seminar is not to raise awareness about the details of the genome or genetic engineering. We are here to discuss questions surrounding ethical questions relating to genome. It's exactly like the kind of questions which can be raised about diabetes blood test, for example. We are not discussing the actual genome, but for example, in each cell we have 3 million or billion characters which determine what will happen. Is it in our interest that we to know what these 3 million characters, what words are they writing or composing? We are not talking about producing insulin in a bacteria to inject it to a human being. So this is the kind of thing which is there as a branch of science or medicine, and Islamic jurisprudence allows that. And so instead of testing for one gene, now they're being tested for 25,000 genes together and to get some information. maybe some of the information we get as a result of it can be frightening, and maybe not. And will this lead to a treatment or not? I don't know. This, that's another matter. It's not what we're here to discuss. You have 1 minute. I give it to Dr. Naeem Yassin. Your minute is the equivalent of 2, so I have 7 minutes rather than 6. These are just comments, really. It's been a very nice meeting. Even if we leave it without understanding much things, at least we have the opportunity to raise some questions. What I understood, at least, is there is a very important matter, which is called the genome, and we can deal with it negatively or positively. It merits some serious research. And when Dr. Ghali called me, and even now he said in the beginning of this seminar that we really require some discussion about the subject and the ethics surrounding it. We are not here to discuss how this is done, how the genome is mapped out. This is not what we're here to discuss. What we're here to discuss is different, is the ethical questions surrounding that and the consequences of it. So if you haven't understood much, that's a good sign, because this means you'll come to the next seminar. I remember one of my lecturers in Damascus University who used to teach us political science and economics and politics. He said he understood something. He said, I know you have not understood these things, he said, because I haven't said anything about them. Some people look at these matters as either you make them understand everything or they come up with nothing. But of course, we are here to exchange ideas. We don't want jurists passing out judgment wholesale, and we do not want scientific experts and doctors with minimal information sometimes demanding final judgments either. And the environment is very important, not just the genes themselves. For example, when it comes to behavior, stuff like that. And of course, having said that, this is not enough, I know. For example, if Parliament wants to legislate a penal code, if someone really has the tendency, for reasons beyond his control, to commit a crime or set fire to something. So how can we judge that from the point of view? Are we going to pass the same judgment on him like someone who does not suffer from that? Because one of them is more ready, if you like, and prepared through reasons beyond his control to commit this crime. God is just. God will take that into consideration because he is aware of it. And Mr. Mukhtar, I agree with you, so I will not comment. And our brother, the psychologist, Dr. Mamoun, mentioned a very important thing, and that is to benefit from and build on the experience of other people. I read the Universal Declaration of human rights, that most of its content is Sharia compatible, and maybe it's not directly linked to Sharia as such, but from the point of view of good and harm, for example, so if other civilizations and societies have produced good things we can benefit from, why not, by all means? And somebody mentioned the verse from the Quran about the state of humanity, how they created. And that the human being are created with a tendency to be, for example, in a state similar to the basis of depression, for example. Some people have a threshold. If they pass that, go beyond it, become like psychologically ill. And in Islam, people who perform the everyday prayer or salah should not reach that threshold easily, because prayer provides them with more, for example, ability to resist that. There's a point I forgot to mention. And that is when you want to balance out the harm and good, not just to determine where the interest lies. And sometimes we do not spell out the rule. We must sift through the evidence, and until we reach a judgment and judge whether or not the pros outweigh the cons, for example, if we can filter these things through exceptions, through measures, through safety nets and checks and balances, etc. If the outcome after all this process, then we come up with a final conclusion, then we can say preventing harm takes precedence on bringing good. This is the principle with it. To the sister who said you terrorized us, I hope she's not saying we are terrorists or anything like that. In this day and age, this can be very dangerous, as you know. We have Dr. Someone asked about any advice. Any advice? I think I say to you, there are many pieces of advice, but we didn't have time to that. I included that in my paper on the methodology which should be implemented when it comes to the human genome, and all of them relate to the methodology and how to deal with this matter. As for awareness raising, I think that this is a complete subject which stands on its own, and it's part and parcel of the human genome, and also the question of ethics relating to that. Also, Dr. Amani, to you I say, I wrote in my paper that there is no branch of science which we can call good and bad, especially when it comes to, there is no such a thing as bad science. What is bad is the bad usage of science, and what's good about science is the good science, because God Almighty has ordered us to acquire all knowledge. when he asked us to contemplate, to look around, to look into ourselves, look into the stars of the universe, because science and knowledge then is the product of looking and viewing and contemplation. So therefore there is no such a thing as bad or good knowledge. How you use it determines that, because God will judge us upon our behavior and what we do. Finally, there's a question I did not understand properly. Who determines whether changing is good or bad according to the interpretation of the Quranic verse? I think you better refer to the commentaries and interpretation, and the commentators really refer to the sayings of the Prophet and his companions and the conditions they implement, and that is what we call tafsir or commentary or exegesis of the Quran has certain conditions. The Prophet himself commented, and his companions did. At-Tabari, as a famous commentator, talks about this methodology. There is, first of all, the interrelatedness of the Quran, that the Quran is explained by the Quran itself, then secondly by the Prophet's sayings, then by people's knowledge, etc. And also the jurisprudence, councils and things lay down the conditions which make a book of tafsir acceptable, and according to that you can conclude from it what kind of change we're talking about. According to, for example, if someone has a very long nose, can he have cosmetic surgery, and will that be considered permissible or not according to the... And there are questions on everything. And both sides, the community of scientists and scholars and the community of jurists, have criticisms and appraisal, because opinions on what is harmful change or good change is determined. This is a very long and complicated debate, which requires really a lot of research, and there are enough papers, and we should, I'm sure when people come to determine that, they will take these questions and others into consideration. Thank you very much. I thank all the presenters. I thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for persevering with us. It's been a long night, and we just want the microphone back, please. Our colleague from the Supreme Council of Health, I want to thank you for this wonderful opportunity, and we hope that Dr. Yasin will come again, and Dr. Muhammad, please, we want more of these seminars. We really need them. And for people who want to know more about the government's policy, the Qatar, we already have a sequencing of 20,000 people. Sidra does that, Qatar Genome Bank does that, and it's now, and we want to understand it from an Islamic ethical point of view. And Her Highness Sheikh Moza announced that we want to genomic sequencing of the entire Qatari population. So we really need to shed more light on that and study it thoroughly. Wishing you all success in your endeavors. Thank you very much and good night. Thank you. And may the blessings of God be upon you all. Thank you.